the ideas.
Thank you, Chair, co-panelists, and my fellow colleagues in IDSA. I've spent 5 years here, and one thing I'd like to mention is that this beautiful setup that you have here, Dr. Santhanam made me run around and acquire the land for it. General Shami Mehta wasn't parting with it, but he used all his manipulative skills and ensured that I carried that letter from Headquarters Western Command and handed it over here so that the complex would come up then under the DRDO architects there. Thank you, sir. I'll cover my talk quickly by giving you a resume of what the operations in Patalik sector was. The reason is that what you have heard about Kargil was primarily of Tiger Hill, Toluling, which are all in the Dharas. All the ceremonies, etc., now also take place there because the memorial is there. The reason is that they were closest to the road, and 8DIV was the division which came in and did the eviction operations from there. But 70 Infantry Brigade, which was in the Kashmir Valley and had gone on loan to the Kashmir Valley for the elections in 1997, was actually a 3DIV formation but was on loan for 2 years just before the Kargil War. And in November of 1998, because the situation had stabilized in the Kashmir Valley, but the firing levels were going on very high in the Ladakh sector. The national highway was being interdicted. There were reports that 5,000 civilians or militants are in somewhere in the FCNA. And Pakistan has bought 5,000 sets of alpine clothing in Austria or some other of these very extreme cold countries. So there was a bit unrest there. And Ladakh sector had got denuded beyond a certain level. This also should be related in the previous setup that after all, when we did the Siachen operation in 1984, there was a 28th division there to back us up in the Ladakh sector. But that 28th division, 8th division had also got sucked into the Kashmir Valley when the CI ops started. So as a result, Ladakh sector was denuded. The situation was ripe for some sort of action there. Now, with this backdrop, 70 Infantry Brigade, I was told, you rush up. Sorry, no battalions for you. At the moment, the winter has already set in. If you can make it across to Jila, well and good. It was November, almost mid. So I rushed with whatever elements I had, a signal company and my skeleton headquarters. And we just managed to cross into the Jila before the pass closed. And the winter I spent doing what any reserve brigade headquarters, which is 70 Brigade's task in the, was in 3DIV, was to do all the war games, get to know the area, plan my tasks, etc. And this culminated into a war game, which was the core war game, where General Mahinder Puri, the 8DIV GOC, was the Redland commander, and I was the made the FCNA commander because we had worked together in 8DIV. I'd worked under him for the last 6 months in 8DIV. The 70 Brigade was looking after from Ganderbal to Zujila. That was my area of responsibility there. So you had worked as FCNA commander. So we drew up the war game. And by and large, the scenario that was played up was what really materialized 1 month later in May. But while the discussions were going on, and this relates to really the top military mechanism that we need to have, that the discussion came up, we said, I was asked this question that can you interdict the national highway? I said, yes, I can, provided I'm allowed certain additional battalions. But that, as for the setting of the war game, I was denied. I didn't put in a request. I was denied. And then I said, I'll be able to interfere with the national highway in such a manner that it'll stop your civilian traffic and even your military induction. So the reply given to me was that, no, we can, and like the way I had also come up, we'll suppress them with artillery fire, we'll move by night, etc. there, and somehow get the military activity going. But the civilian activity, yes, will be difficult, and probably the tourist season won't be on. Which one said that that may not be acceptable to the civilian public, but notwithstanding, why it gained importance because just some time after that, the Bajpai government lost by a single vote in the parliament, and they went into a caretaker government. And because of that, then the various compulsions can be probably interpreted there. Because what I was told at that time is, let him come and sit down for 6 months. he'll have to go back in winter, won't he? And I agreed with them that in winters nobody could have survived with that kind of intrusion. But the question was, can you allow enemy to sit down for 6 months? So that is where I leave it. That was the war game. The second question which came out in the war game was that what will this reports of 5,000 civilian clothed militants or whatever they are and this alpine clothing, what will these people do? I played it up as an intrusion, but the mindset of the core headquarters was it was a counterinsurgency mindset because it had taken its toll on their mindset, I think, for the last 8 years because the insurgency had been going on in the Kashmir Valley. So they said, no, they'll use this route from Ladakh and give a fillip to the dying down of the insurgency movement that is going on. They'll give it a fillip by inducting these people, 5,000 people. So that would be so, I mean, that was where the war game ended. But it did manifest itself in a lot of things like what you call it, the WASO sorties, the winter air surveillance sorties. Since you cannot patrol along the line of control, you have to resort to army evasion and other helicopters helping you go along the line of control to see for any movement. But their pattern had got changed to not along the line of control, but along the valleys, because somehow the mindset was that there'll be infiltration. And if there's infiltration, they are going to come along the from the watershed along the valleys, and therefore the winter surveillance sorties should be along the valleys. So this much was discussed to say that we are not honest with ourselves. We were honest, and we discussed all these aspects. And this was fresh in our minds when a month later, on 3rd of May, metallic intrusion was detected, and being a reserve brigade headquartered without any task, I was asked to go in on 8th of May by General Budwar that move to Batalik. Troops will be released later and your task is to evict the Batalik sector. I reached on 3 Punjab, which was the local battalion there, and then did a recce quickly. And by 11th of May, 9th, they were released. 111 GR and 12 Jackalai, both fresh from Siachen, but 1/3 of their strength. With hardly any equipment, etc., advance party gone, leave party gone, and they were released for the task. So it took them quite some time, about 20-25 days, to really get into action. In between, attack was to be launched by 111 GR within 4 days of coming. And that is where one aspect came up, which, as one of the challenges to leadership, was where it was not only I insist on the physical courage, but I insist that there's a moral courage element involved. That the 2IC was officiating, the CEO had put in his papers and gone. He got a call from the army commander, GR battalion, you have to lead the attack, etc. But when I talked to the gentleman who later on did a very good job throughout, but who really got the PVC later, Manoj Pandey, he says, sir, I said, what are your chances of success? He says, there are, I've got an ice face of about 700 to 800 meters ahead of me, and by the time I go across it, climb it up, we are only 60 people in strength. I'll take about an hour and a half to get across that. And I said, what's the casualty scene like? So he says, sir, not even, I don't think any of them will survive. Your chances of success, he says, not even 0.5%. Spoke to the 2IC. He also gave me some 1% success. But that is the time I conveyed. I said, this attack is murder. And that is what really came up as a, point of contention, that the eviction, is it so necessary at this stage, or can we take more time to be more deliberate and then deliver the attack? So finally, this action kept on going on. The only moral superiority I had that time was that I was not part of the intrusion blame game, and I had come up from behind. And therefore, when I tried to raise the level up, nobody was ready to call off the attack. So at finally, after it was almost 11:55 or something like that at night, I prevailed upon General Budwar. He says, okay, then you send me a log that you're calling off the attack on your orders. And therefore, one had to send off a log saying that attack called off on the brigade commander's orders. And there was hell to pay the next day, lose, why, when, wow, you had done it. But then I think, like I said, in military, you have to make these choices. These choices are, if you have to carry on there. But having said that, There was no shortage of courage, no shortage of physical effort by the people in Batalik sector. And I'll now flash a few slides for you to show that Batalik sector, though the most remote, the comparatively the higher altitude sector, and not covered by the media, but just carry on with the slides, please. But the end results, this is the Munthodalo you're talking about, and this area is covered as a bowl. Next. Now, just read this, and this is from, not from me, this is from the headquarters 15 Corps by the Corps commander. You can read it for yourselves. That by 9th of July, Batalik is cleared, but the last line says Draz and Mashku are still being cleared. Next. This is from the Heroes of Kargil, a book by Army Headquarters, about 70 Brigade. Next, this is by General Y.M. Bami, who wrote a very exhaustive book. Next, this is some of the POWs who gave you the information of the intrusion. Actually, the one on the right, he was captured very early in the war, and he gave us the complete layout and the strength of the enemy. Next, this is what General Lokdev just said, that out of the 17 battalions which received the battle and theater honors, seven of them were from 17th Infantry Brigade. Thank you. Having said this much, we'll now cover what really were the challenges apart from this aspect of handling in this sector. One was the command and control. 17 Infantry Brigade started off from a zero battalion scenario to a 11 battalion scenario, all within a period of 60 days. 8th of May, the task was given. That is 9th of May, I took over the sector. And by 9th of July, you have read that the sector was cleared. How these battalions came in, how were they, we gelled together, not having known each other. At times 10 days or 15 days, we had not even talked to this thing. Everything was on a patched up airline. There were no, on a patched up telephone line. There were no communications there. It was a totally unoccupied sector. And, but what really connected us was that the factors are numerous. The factors are somebody turned out to be a higher command student, somebody turned out to be knew you from somewhere else, somewhere you had done the course along with somebody. So really it was a matter of how you gel it. But really the issue which helped us was that having realized very early in the after doing the recce that Batalik sector was compartmentalized into 4 or 5 valleys that were coming. And therefore it was very necessary that we establish some sort of a command and control in each of these valleys. Why? Because the troops were becoming available piecemeal. Unlike 8th Infantry Division, which came to from the Kashmir Valley in a proper coherent form, Ladakh sector had been on a low priority and did not have, for weapons, for troops, etc. And whatever was being made available to 70 Brigade was in bits and pieces. A Ladakh stuck-out company, a five-para company from the glacier, so and so forth. So when they were coming in, I did induct them into a compartment. That compartment was line was 2 to 3 days ahead of the road head. So once they went in, there was really very little touch with them. And if I wanted to launch an attack, attack, I realized they had nothing with them. They used to say, I've got a list of deficiencies without which I really can't do the job. So the way was out is then I'd be sent in another company. That company, somebody had to coordinate between these companies to be, you had to make one person completely naked, even take off his shirt, give it to the other people. And in the Indian Army, we know that one battalion will never give, or nobody else will hand over their weapons, ammunition, etc. to somebody else. So it required somebody else to coordinate the job on the ground. So I had no option. I had no option but to divide my brigade headquarter up. My brigade major was up in one compartment. My deputy commander, Indrabalan, I think his Army headquarters now, Brigade Indrabalan, there. And Colonel Vinu Thomas, who was a deputy commander, no more. He was on one this thing. I was on another one. And the flanks, we had left it open. When a solid full battalion came in, one Bihar came in, I gave them Jubar. 14 Sikh came in, I gave them Chor Batla, but in between these were ad hoc ones, and their job was, we had served 6 months together, but the battalions we had not served, or the other units we had not served with together, but they managed to then take your mindset, okay, now make everybody naked, take it, equip this person, he tries the attack. He fails, the other person tries the attack. But all the sweeping, swapping was done, and that is how we managed to create a setup in which we were functioning. At the end of this thing, we realized that when we captured the POWs, that there were 600 to 800 intruders. General Malik, on return from Poland, had laid a ratio of 1:15, which was the standard ratio of 1:3 for attacker versus a defender. But there was a kind of he visited the sector in Chor Batla on the 10th of June. And there my assessment was 600 to 800. Somewhere I was put down saying that's 40 to 45 militants only there. And that led to this thing, a bit of a powwow there. But in the end, the tolling was captured on 13th of June, 3 days later. And the corps commander has gone on record that only after the capture of tolling was he of the mindset that after having captured heavy weaponry, that they were regulars. And I then started getting some troops released to me. By 20th, 21st of June, I had captured 0.5203. That was my first success compared to tolling in the RAS sector. And thereafter, we made a plan of 7 battalions concentrated, going in encirclement movement and encircling Munthod Halo. And that is where the Air Force came in. I'll say that both the artillery and the Air Force were otherwise not effective in so effective really in this sector. Why? Because we were encircling these positions, and any miss, you could go and land 4 to 5 kilometers or 3 kilometers down where our troops were. But Munthod Halo was one such area, and maybe Jubar for artillery, and Munthod Halo for both artillery and Air Force, where they played a great role, because it was a bowl. They were free, they could and the rounds would not go in, or the bombs could not go anywhere. They had to fall in that bowl. So therefore, as a selection of target, I would say that Munthod Halo was ideal and the most effective use of the Air Force and artillery also. Second is that unlike Dras sector, here there was no artillery which would be used in direct fire. Why? Because the artillery was all at Hampu Tingla, which was on the Kargil there, and from there they were firing. We had only my own regiment, which I commanded, 307 medium there, and 15 field and 4 field, but which were located there. But otherwise, the bulk of the artillery was all being made available to us from the Kargil sector. And at extreme ranges, it had its own share of inaccuracy. Lastly is the attack technique. The features which we are attacking here were 3,500 feet from where we were in the valley or in the nalas or the compartments. This 3,500 feet cannot be done in one night. And if you started the attack when you were doing fire and move, by somewhere 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock morning, you realize that you are being daylighted and the attack used to get stalled. So we had to come up with some other fresh method. But we tried this on the first 5203 and we succeeded. The method was that we said, stop worrying about their, of any fire and move. Simply we made in every company 2 rods of people with only their weapon, their ammunition, 1 water bottle, and some shakarpara ration, that is all. And they were leading, and with them, their heavy baggage was being carried by their colleagues who were the fighting porters. And we made these two each from each company, three companies attacking six rods. And we covered the feature from almost 180 degrees all sides and then attacked. Result was that the enemy was there, fire and move it was doing, but their fire was not accurate. They were only firing, up the, I mean, for the, in the during the night without accuracy. So we managed to really, because these light columns were light, they managed to reach the top by 2:30 in the morning. And once we had reached the top, the objectives were ours. This method we then utilized when we did the 7th Battalion attack, and which started on 28 June. And by 3rd or 4th of July, we had got Stangba, we had got Khalubar, we had got 4812, we had got Jubbar, we had got this thing there. And then we went through Munthadalo for the next 4 days, and line of control was with us by 9th of July. That really sums up our end of the operations. lastly was the aspect of under-assessment. We did have, again, a fair degree of problem because of the under-assessment, because the troops were not being released. But then the prisoners of war we captured really helped us. And there was a problem with the prisoners of war also. They were caught so much ahead that they were wounded. Our own troops, 8 people had to carry them on stretchers and bring them back because they were worth their weight in gold, and they gave us the enemy dispositions. And this enemy dispositions therefore helped us deal with them better. It also helped me get more allocation for myself, because otherwise we were on lower priority than Dras and Mashko sector, and got the troops later on as the operations developed. That's all. Thank you.